Feminist Creativist presents A Word for Every Generation That Knows No Fashion.
Greetings. I hope and trust I do find well, my dear friends. We have one more experience as we consider our mountaintop experience installment. Our title for this devotional is The God of the Gibeonites. Come with me to 2 Samuel. We begin reading at chapter 21. And we'll begin reading at verse number 1. This is what the Holman Bible says. During David's reign, there was a famine for 3 successive years. So David inquired of the Lord. The Lord answered, "It is because of the blood shed by Saul and his family when he killed the Gibeonites." The Gibeonites were not Israelites, but rather a remnant of the Amorites. The Israelites had taken an oath concerning them, but Saul had tried to kill them in his zeal for the Israelites and Judah. So David summoned the Gibeonites and spoke to them. He asked the Gibeonites, "What should I do for you? How can I make atonement so that you will bring a blessing to the Lord's inheritance?" The Gibeonites say to him, "We are not asking for money from Saul or his family, and we cannot put anyone to death in Israel." "Whatever you say, I will do for you," he said. Verse 5, they replied to the king, "As for the man who annihilated us and plotted to destroy us, so we will not exist within the whole territory of Israel. Let 7 of his male descendants be handed over to us, so we may hang them in the presence of the Lord at Gibeah of Saul, the Lord's chosen." The king answered, "I will hand them over." Skip to verse 9. They hanged them on the hill in the presence of the Lord. The 7 of them died together. May the good Lord bless the reading of his word as we spend a moment in prayer. Kind and gracious Father in the heavens above, thank you, dear Lord, for the privilege of considering thy word. I am sure you have nuggets that will help us appreciate our business environment. And above all, appreciate your will for us as your children. Be with us as we start this working week and save us into thy kingdom. This is our prayer of faith. In Jesus' name we pray and we ask, amen. My good friends, as our custom is, why don't you allow me to raise our usual 5 points. And these are the points. At point number 1, you'll notice that a hunger has ensued for 3 years, pursued Israel with a vengeance, pursued Israel with the venom and strength that they cannot even understand what has gone wrong, until David goes to inquire of the Lord, only to learn that this hunger is on account of a former king. It is on account of the late Saul. What am I saying unto you as you go into the business space? Take note, there is something that is known as liability. And liability basically is as follows. For every incorporated entity, incorporated company, what it means is that the liability does not rest solely on the directors, but it rests on the corporate entity itself. So your actions that are done during your tenure are going to bind those who are going to succeed you. So the deeds of the predecessor are binding on the successor. What David has to deal with is what Saul had done wrong. So as you walk into the office, appreciate this. You cannot say, "I was not there during that time. I know nothing about this." That is not a valid excuse in a business space. In every business space, this is what obtains. Whatever was done by your predecessor, it is your duty to clean up. Should any problems arise from the time they have been away, you are going to have to deal with those things. Such is the business environment. Move over to point number 2. These people were not Israelites. The Bible makes it clear. They were the remnants of the Amorites, the Gibeonites, that is. What had happened? The Gibeonites, as soon as the Israelites checked into Canaanite land, they had heard of how the Israelites had conquered every nation. Secondly, they had heard how God had been rumored to have told the Israelites, "When you get to the promised land, make sure you remove and destroy every citizen and every nationality of the new place. Replace them. And as they heard this, they presented themselves to the Israelites as sojourners from a distant land. They carried bread that was supposedly stale and bags of wine that had grown old during the journey, and they sought to become a part of the Israelite territory that was in the times of Joshua. Joshua then saw to the Gibeonites by the name of the Lord that they were going to be safe as long as they remained in Israel. And later on, about 3 days later, he discovered that they had hoodwinked him. Upon realizing this, he then downgraded them from citizens to people who were going to be hewers of wood and those who were going to ferry water into the temple of the Lord. And because of that oath, in spite of people complaining, the Gibeonites became a part of the Israelite community. And what am I stressing here? We need a people who are going to say yes, and a yes is a yes for life. People are going to say no, and a no is a no for life. When you have sworn by the name of the Lord, it stands till death do you part. Some of us sow in a marriage, and we say till death do us part, and such is our commitment. It is for life and never for a short while. And so this is what has happened. But so, having failed to appreciate that the deeds of a predecessor, they bind the successor, he goes on to try and annihilate the Gibeonites. And in so doing, he quotes the ire of God. At point number 3, not only should we be bound by what we have sworn, not only should we be bound by the oath, we should also guard against a misguided zeal. The misguided zeal is evidenced in Saul. How does Saul go about this? He goes about annihilating. He goes about destroying. He goes about killing and seeking to carry out a genocide against the Gibeonites. Why? So as to appease the Israelites and those of Judah. There is a serious problem where we find ourselves appeased, tickled by the death of a soul, where we find ourselves, so much thrilled by the death and loss of a life. There is a problem there, a fundamental problem, where we are appeased by such and where we carry out such acts in order to make sure that we appease the onlookers. There is a lot of damage that comes thereby. There is the Saul who is in the New Testament and later on became Saul. When he was zealous for a misunderstood cause, he went about persecuting the believers. When the Roman leaders of the day sought to appease the Jews, what did they do? They went on to assassinate and even kill all the disciples of God. They went off one by one, being killed so that people could be appeased. What is wrong with the generations of men? How can we find pleasure in the death and loss of a life? This is a misguided zeal and should not be entertained in our midst. At point number 4, the Gibeonites came in as the remnants of the Amorites. They sought to be a part of Israel. The Israelites who were blessed, the Israelites who communed in the presence of the Lord, the Israelites who inquired directly from God. But now the same Israelites who have been blessed find themselves at the mercy of the Gibeonites for them to continue and remain being blessed. For verse 3 says, what should I do for you? Listen to how David puts it. How can I make atonement so that you, the Gibeonites, will bring a blessing to the Lord's inheritance? Some of us, we have the Lord's inheritance, but the blessing is no more. Because we have sought to victimize others, we have sought to undo that which God has done, we have sought to reverse the oath that has been made in the name of the Lord. There is no sanctity or integrity in our word, and as a result, blessings have been taken away from us. Hunger upon hunger, strife upon strife continues to be our allotment because the blessing has been reversed. And where does it rest? With those whom we have victimized. Until we get their pardon, until we get their blessing, things will not move with us because the Lord has willed it. And lastly, point number 5. Notice this. Verse number 9 says, they were hung. The 7 of them died together in the presence of the Lord. Where at Gibeah of Saul, all these seven descendants of Saul, they were hung in the presence of the Lord. The principle is very clear. God will not lift up a finger to defend the unjust. God is not going to lift up a finger to defend the murderers. When we go on a path of evil, even though we have been with the Lord before, even though the Lord has spoken to us firsthand, even though the Lord has loved us, He will not lift a finger. He is not the God of the Israelites exclusively. He is the God of the Gibeonites too. He is not the God of those in power. He is the God of those who are being ruled. He is not the God of those who have the support of the army. He is the God of those who are having to run for life, and He will protect them. He will deliver them. He will defend them. He is the God of the victimized. Take note, He is not your God alone. He is the God of the oppressed. My dear friends, what have I said unto you? We talk about the God of Israel. Today, meet the God of the Gibeonites, the God of the downtrodden, the God of the oppressed. Until we meet again on Friday. Blessings and peace.